This is a friendly, no prerequisites deep learning tutorial. So if you know literally nothing, as long as you can add 5 plus 5 and get the value of 10, then you can understand this tutorial. You may not understand what every single piece of code does, but I'm going to explain what it's doing. And if you do know the code, that's great. But if you don't, that's totally fine. It generally starts with a data set. So we're going to load in the very classic example of the MNIST handwritten digits data set. So in the first block of code, we load in the dataset, and in the second block of code here, we use a graphing library called matplotlib, which simply shows one of the pictures. So our dataset is full of many pictures, and I grab the first one. It's a 5. In this tutorial, we're going to create a deep learning model that is able to predict what digit this is given this picture. So it looks at the picture, and then it says, oh, I think this is a 5, most likely. Just like in normal math, when we have an x-axis and a y-axis, we think about the x as the input and the y as the output. It's the same thing here. We have an x, which actually the first thing is a 28 by 20 image. That's what we're looking at right here. So that's the 28 by 28 here. And the 5, what I showed here, is that that's what this thing actually is. It's the digit 5. Now, what this image actually is a 28 by 28 array of pixels. And don't be confused by that. It actually just means a bunch of numbers in a certain shape. So the shape is 28 by 28, meaning we have 28 different rows here, and we have 28 different columns, and that equals a square, which is 28 by 28 equals 784 pixels. In a computer, it is 784 values that looks like this, and most of them are zero, because you can see the black parts, that is zero, and the more yellow parts, that is closer to 255. Normally, we don't have just one input. We don't just have one picture and then one label, one input, one output. We generally have multiple inputs and their corresponding outputs. We actually have here in total, train x, if I look at its shape, that says we actually have 60,000 different 28 by 28. So we have 60,000 of these images, and also in this train y thing, if I look at its shape, we have 60,000. And that makes sense because we have 60,000 inputs, 60,000 pictures, and 60,000 labels. Each of them correspond to what that image actually is. Now again, we're hoping to create a machine learning or deep learning model that is able to take this as an image and predict and know that it's a 5. This doesn't seem very useful right now because here we have all of the labels saying this one's a 5, that's a 7, that's a 9. Except the point is to automate this process so that in the future when we don't have this is a 5, this is a 7, all we have is the actual image of this thing, not the label, then it can predict that for us. It would be theoretically possible to create an algorithm that gets 100% accuracy every time by knowing every single pixel combination here. Except there's so many different combinations of what a 5 could be. This is a 5, a slight change is a 5, even some noise around here is still a 5, and so we need it to be flexible. To do this, we're going to train the model through trial and error and show it examples of saying, hey, this is what a 5 looks like, this is also what a 5 looks like, and it won't get perfect accuracy, but we should train it so that it gets pretty good. Now we're going to use something called a neural network as our model, and I'm not going to explain every single thing about the network. I'm going to explain the parts that we need to understand what it's doing to train the model and get it better at solving our task. Here we're going to use the Keras library. So I'm going to use from tensorflow.keras.models, we're going to import sequential model. And so what a sequential is a list of layers. It's going to have an input. Our input layer is going to take an image that looks like this, and our output has got to be a probability distribution. And don't get confused or intimidated here. All we're going to output is the probability of it being a 0, a probability of it being a 1, up to the probability of being a 9, and so then we're just going to take the one with the highest probability as our answer because that's the one we think it is. So without worrying too much about the exact layers just yet, we're going to need to add an input layer, and that basically specifies what kind of thing we want to input, and we're going to say it's a 28 by 28 image right here. Then after that, we would need to add hidden layers, which are basically just the middle layers, so after the input layer and before the output layer. And this specifies a lot of hidden magic that we're not going to talk about too much in this video, but we'll give some intuition for it. Finally, we have to add the output layer, and that's what actually says what we want to produce at the end. And we want the output layer to be a vector of probabilities. The first thing is going to be probability of 0, second probability of 1, and so on. So to get layers, we go to from tensorflow.keras.layers. We're going to import many different layers. And so it turns out what we're going to need, some of them make sense right now, some of them don't. We're going to need input layer. We're going to need this thing called softmax, and that's what actually means the probability vector. So that's going to be the output input layer, and in the middle, we're going to have two things, which are dense, which does a bunch of computations, will give some intuition, and we also have this flattened thing, which will make sense shortly. So that was just comments, but to actually construct our model, we need to add layers. And so all we do is first create a sequential model, where we say model is equal to sequential, and then we add our layers right here. So we're going to add this thing called an input layer first, and so we'll do model.addInputLayer, and then we'll give that the shape, so that is just 28 by 28. That specifies we want an image like this. It's the first thing we do. Now the first thing we'll do in our hidden layer is this thing called a flatten. So all we do here is model.addFlatten, and what that specifies is that we actually want to convert this from a 28 by 28 image into a long vector, which just means you can picture stretching all of these 784 things out into a long piece. So we basically have the first row down like this, the second row after that, the third row after that, and so it flattens it into 784 things. Now we're going to do some hidden magic, which basically we add this thing called dense, and I'm going to pick a number that's bigger than 8, say something like 64. Usually we use powers of 2. We're going to add 64 of these things, and we're going to add something that's basically some particular function we don't have to worry about that is good at doing this computation. We choose the activation to be ReLU. We don't want this to be 64 things. Right now we actually mean is we turn it from 28 by 28 into 784 things, and then we're turning it into 64 values. Now we don't want it as 64, we need to turn this into 10 values, and so we'll do model.addDense 10, and we're going to choose the activation equal to linear, which basically means we want a value between negative infinity and infinity, except we don't want 10 of those values, we want 10 probabilities. We want the first thing here to be the probability of 0, second thing to be probability of 1, and so on. We don't want this linear thing, that's negative infinity to infinity. What we want to add is this thing called softmax. Basically, it's a smart way it transforms these into probabilities. We can very nicely see exactly what our model is doing by writing model.summary, and so that is going to show first it starts as a 28 by 28, then we flatten it into 784 things, that's just 28 times 28, and then we turn it into 64 things, which I chose somewhat arbitrarily. Then I made sure it turned into 10 things because we have 10 different digits, and then I turned them with a softmax so that these are probabilities. Deep learning as a whole is about changing these different layers to adjust to your problem, as well as doing the following. Recall that we want to train our model by feeding it input-output pairs of our pictures and what that label is, but we still have to specify what we call a loss function that says how good or bad our model is. It turns out for us, we're going to use something called the categorical cross-entropy, and that's because we're trying to classify different categories or classes or types, which is just which handwritten digit it is. Now, for our purposes, it doesn't matter too much about what this loss function is, but we do need to know it's a function that produces a value between 0 and infinity, and that the higher the value is, that means our model's not doing very well. It's a lot of error. And if it's close to 0, that means there's a very low error or low loss. So now what we have to do is we call it compiling the model. So we write model.compile, and we have to specify a few things. We know we have to specify the loss function, and so we do loss is equal to categorical cross-entropy, and we also need to specify something called an optimizer, which is basically an algorithm that we choose to try and minimize this loss, because that's what we want to do. If we get a low error, that means we're doing pretty well. We're going to use something that we call atom, and we're going to put that in strings, and don't really worry too much about what that actually is. Another thing we should specify, we don't really know what this categorical cross-entropy is. You can look the function up yourself, except it's still kind of weird. What we do really like, everyone likes, the notion of accuracy, and we understand that. Basically, if you have, say, 50,000 correct, and it got 10,000 wrong, so it's got 50,000 of 60,000, or 5 over 6, so it got an 83% accuracy. We obviously want a high accuracy rather than a low accuracy. Now, we're almost ready to train our model, except we're not quite ready yet because we have to adjust the output a little bit. We have this thing called train y, which is our list of labels. The first is a 5, the second is a 0, and so on. It's okay like this for us, except for the optimizer to work and Keras to work, we actually need to do something like this. We need to transform it into something called one-hot encoding. So I'm going to put it here. And so basically what this is instead of having each digit saying what number it actually is, it's basically turning each of them into a vector of 10 different things. Let me show you. So if we have 10 different digits, let me show you this. We basically turn each of them into a vector like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 different digits, except for each of these, whichever position is, we're going to change that position into a 1. So I'm just going to put labels up here so you can see this is for 0, this is for 1, 2, and so on. So for the first thing, we're going to convert that into this vector. It's specifying that it's a 5. And for the second one here, it's a 0, we're going to convert it into this. We can do this all in one with a very nice Kira's utility function. As we can see, looking at the shape of this thing, it's no longer just 60,000 items, it's 60,000 10-dimensional vectors. And so we can look at the first one, for example, is going to be this, as we saw. So now we're ready to train the model, and in Kira's terms, that means calling model.fit. We pass it the input, train x, and the output, train y, and then we also need to specify one thing, which is something called epochs. That basically means how many runs through the dataset we want to do. This dataset is 60,000 things. How many times do we want to see these 60,000 items? Don't worry too much about the number. Let's just pick, say, 5 and see what happens. We've successfully trained the model, and we can see after each epoch, or run through the dataset, the loss that is going down over time, we have an accuracy that is going up over time. It makes sense that they're going different directions. Loss, you want to go down. Accuracy, you want to go up. And so in general, this is good. It's not totally true that this is necessarily good, but we'll have that conversation at a later time. So this is great. Our model went from 81% accuracy all the way up until 93% accuracy. Except if we look closely, we ignore this thing called train. This is the information that we're using to train the model. We also, way up here at the very beginning, ignored this thing called test x and test y. These look exactly the same as train, except, well, these are actually 10,000 examples. We happen to have less of them, but it's 10,000 images and 10,000 labels saying what they are. So if this is the data we use to train the model, well, we can guess that it's going to be pretty good at predicting on this data because it's actually adjusting the model itself as to fit that data well. It's trying to get better and better at fitting that data set, except that's not actually what we want it to do in reality. We want it to be good at predicting data that it hasn't seen before. We want it to pass random digits that are on a piece of paper that we don't know the actual label for. Well, we're going to confirm that it does well on data that it hasn't seen before by now measuring its accuracy on the test set. Now, to set this up, we only have to do the same transformation that we did for the train y before, except with the test y. So we have to set test y equal to the 2 categorical of test y, and do that basically just change it to 1 hot like we did the other one, and we'll see again that shape is right here. And now we can call this thing called evaluate. So we can do model.evaluate, and then we pass it the test x, and we pass it the test y, and we see its score is 93% as well. So only slightly worse on the test set that we did on the train set. Very, very good accuracy as well. So to recall what we did, because it's very commonly the same workflow, we grab a data set, we visualize it and understand what we're doing with it. We build some type of model architecture here, maybe a neural network. We're going to visualize our neural network and understand what it's doing for sure. We're going to define the loss function, the optimizer, and some way of understanding the accuracy of this thing. We might do some sort of processing to the input or output to make sure it works with our network, and then we're going to fit the model. Hopefully loss goes down and accuracy goes up. And finally, we need to make sure that our model does good on data we haven't seen before, so we need to make sure that its accuracy is good on the test set as well. If you like the video, please drop a like, it helps a lot, and subscribe if you're not. I really hope you want to.